Well, hello and welcome. Thank you for joining us for our worship service today, and so thankful for each and every one of you. Welcome to our Abundant Life family. I miss you, miss seeing you, and we miss your smiling faces. We miss being able to greet and shake hands and hug and all of the wonderful things we do, but I am so thankful for technology that allows us the ability to connect and to share and to worship together. So welcome. Welcome, Canton Calvary Assembly of God. Welcome to Olivet First Assembly of God. Welcome to new friends and family members and those of you that have made your way to this video. Thank you for joining us. I'm trusting today in Palm Sunday on this teaching that you're going to be blessed and encouraged and strengthened. And so I'm excited about what the Lord has in store. I do want to let you know that at the end of service today, we are going to be taking communion. And if you would gather something, whatever you have in your house that you could use as elements for communion, most ideally grape juice, that's what I have today, and in some form of unleavened bread or regular bread. But if you don't have grape juice, find the best you can do, some kind of liquid to drink that would represent the blood of Jesus, and some form of bread or cracker to represent his broken body. And gather that in at the end of service, 30 to 40 minutes, maybe more from now, we'll be sharing together in Holy Communion. And kids can join in with that. Everyone who's a follower of Jesus, we would love for you to join in with communion today. Just a couple more things. On Wednesday nights, we are continuing our Bible study. We have made our subject matter our daily Bible reading that we've put out through the Abundant Life. It's on our website. We've handed out little sheets. But for this week, starting April 6th, is 1 Corinthians 1, 2, 3, and following. So that's going to be our study this Wednesday, 1 Corinthians 1, 2, and 3. We're using a platform called Zoom, Z-O-O-M, and I can't believe it, but last Wednesday we had 25 people, 25 actual devices connected. We were able to interact and see each other. Could I encourage you to give it a try? You can dial in by phone if you don't have a computer or internet. If you do have a smartphone or a computer, you can connect with the link that we send out. And some of you are scared to turn your video on, but I got to tell you, it is healthy. It is affirming. It is encouraging to interact with each other and to see your smiling faces. So I would encourage you, use your phone or your computer, but if you have a camera on that, leave it on and join in the conversation Wednesday night, 6:30 p.m. Lastly, we're going to make a small adjustment to our service schedule. We are going to give our worship team a break for a little while. It takes about six people in the building for us to pull off the worship experience we've been producing, and we just want to be safe and smart during this season and allow that team to have a break. So we're going to show a worship video, just short, one song, in just a second here. I encourage you, just enter in, worship along with me, and in 3 or 4 minutes from right now, I'm going to be back and bring this Palm Sunday sermon. So join with me as we worship the Lord. Thank you. Amen. Amen. I just want to pray over you this morning, and we're going to jump into this morning's message. Lord, I thank you for friends and family that are joined together by way of video. And we just declare your glory, your favor, your anointing, and your blessing upon each and every one. We declare your health and covering, your encouragement and strength. And Lord, I ask today that Holy Spirit bring revelation, knowledge, insight, and understanding. Bring encouragement to our souls. Let your word take root in our thoughts and in our life, and bring us hope and strength. And Holy Spirit, help use this word today to encourage many. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. Well, hey, it is Palm Sunday, and whether you're watching this morning or watching a recording, we are celebrating that season. We're heading towards the Easter resurrection season, and it's just an exciting time to be a Christian. It's so many things happened in the Scriptures, culminating at the cross, and that journey to the cross began with what we call the triumphal entry or the Palm Sunday experience. Just a reminder, once again, we will be sharing communion at the end of service. If you haven't obtained elements yet, please do at some point in the next little bit, we are going to share that at the conclusion of the service. Palm Sunday. Luke chapter 22, verse 1 says this, "Now the feast of unleavened bread, called the Passover, was approaching." So Jesus had made what was called the triumphal entry, and that's really traditionally what we would talk about on Palm Sunday. But I was drawn to really what we could call the Last Supper, which happened later in the week of this Passover week, or of this during this Feast of Unleavened Bread. And really, Israel had seven feasts. The first three, which happened in the springtime, were called Passover, Pentecost, and Tabernacles. And then they represent that early season of spring. And then, I'm sorry, I said that wrong. The first season, Passover, included Passover, unleavened bread, and the first fruits. The fourth feast was called Pentecost. And then in the fall, the season was called Tabernacles, which included the Feast of Trumpets, Day of Atonement, and then the Feast of Tabernacles. So Jesus made his triumphal entry, and it's this season of unleavened bread. It's all kind of lumped together, often referred to as the Passover season, which culminates at the Passover meal. And that's what we're going to focus on for today. The original Passover, if you will, happened in the book of Exodus. And in Exodus chapter 12, the children of Israel had been because of the famine, and the story of Joseph had ended up in Egypt. As leadership changed in Egypt, the Israelites became slaves. And now it's been approaching 400 years in Egypt. And this is when Moses comes, and all of a sudden there's the plagues, the blood, the frogs, the gnats, all of these things happening. And the final plague of 10 was the death of the firstborn. And this is when God introduces the idea of the Passover. I'm going to read for you Exodus 12 then. That's the context. And it says, "The Lord said to Moses and Aaron in Egypt," they were the leaders, "this month is to be for you the first month of the first of your year. Tell the whole community of Israel on the 10th day of this month, take a lamb for his family, one for each household, a lamb. And he gives some instructions. If your house is too small to eat a lamb, get together with your neighbor so that you're not wasteful. Verse 5 says, "The animal you choose must be a year-old male without defect, and you may take it from the sheep or the goats. Take care of them until the 14th day, and then slaughter them at twilight." The perfect lamb. We're going to get into that. Obviously, it's a picture and a foreshadowing of Jesus. Verse 7, "Then they are to take some of the blood, put it on the sides and the tops of the door frames of the houses when they eat the lambs. And that same night, they are to eat the meat, the lamb, roasted over fire, along with bitter herbs and bread made without yeast. Do not eat the meat raw or cooked in water. Roast it over fire. Do not leave any till morning. If some is left, you must burn it. and he gives them some instruction. Remember, this is Passover. They're getting ready to be delivered out of captivity. So he says, for you, eat it with your coat tucked in, your sandals on your feet, your staff in your hand. Eat it in haste. It's the Lord's Passover. And this is the promise. On that night, I will pass through Egypt and strike down every firstborn, men and animals, and bring judgment on the little g, the gods of Egypt, for I am the Lord. Now listen to this, verse 13. The blood will be a sign for you on the house where you are. When I see the blood, I will pass over you. No destructive plague will touch you when I strike Egypt. Isn't that interesting language? No destructive plague will touch you when I strike Egypt. This is a day you're to commemorate for generations to come. You shall celebrate it as a festival to the Lord, a lasting ordinance for 7 days. This is where the whole festival comes in. For 7 days, you're to eat bread made without yeast. On the first day, remove the yeast from your home. And he goes on saying, you have to do that. Hold a sacred assembly, one on the seventh day. Do not work on those days. Celebrate the Feast of Unleavened Bread, because it was on this day that I brought your divisions up out of Egypt. Celebrate this day as a lasting ordinance for generations to come. Passover. So this was the original Passover, and God Himself gave them the instructions, and God Himself said, you should celebrate this for an ongoing, lasting ordinance unto the Lord. But the point of this very first one was what? They had been in bondage for 400 years. The point is that they needed God's protection. They needed a miracle. They needed deliverance. They had not only an enemy in Egypt who was holding them captive, but they had a looming plague, the death of the firstborn. God used the word plague, the 10 plagues. And this was coming, and they needed protection. The primary factors or points of this first Passover were, guess what? The lamb, right? The body. They were to take a lamb, a one-year-old lamb, as good as they could find without defect, because it was representing the Lamb of God. So they were to take a lamb, and they were to slaughter it, or really, it was in essence a sacrifice. It was a slaughtering. It was to be given pure, spotless, roasted in fire, eaten completely. An obvious picture of Jesus. You know, it's interesting. They were to consume the whole lamb, and I don't want to get off track this morning, but it's a picture that we are to take all of Jesus. When we become a follower of Jesus, sometimes we like to pick and choose the things we like. And can I encourage you? They didn't say, you know, take the lamb chops. Boy, those are my favorite. Marinated lamb chops. Oh, baby. You know, they didn't say just pick the finer cuts of meat. They said, eat the whole lamb. Don't waste anything. Why? Because it's a picture that we are to take all of Jesus into all of our life. And he talked about bread without yeast, another picture going forward of the body of Christ. Jesus said, I am the bread of life, right? And bread represents his body. And we're going to get to that soon with our communion meal. So they had bread without leaven, again, representing purity, holiness, separation. Not the leaven or the yeast would represent sin oftentimes. And a lesser part of the story, but interesting nonetheless, is that they ate it with bitter herbs. I find that interesting. As best I can tell, it was really a remembrance. The lamb was tasty. The lamb has a bit of a sweetness and a wonderful flavor to it, and it would counteract the bitterness of the bitter herbs. And it was really a picture that the lamb helps us through the bitter seasons and brings us freedom and deliverance. It was the end of their bitterness of bondage and captivity. And I just want to encourage you that the Lamb of God, Jesus, helps us through difficult times and bitter seasons. So the lamb, the body, was certainly at the core. But what, you know what else was the second part? The blood. Right? The blood. They would slaughter that lamb, and there was a critical part to this story, is that they had to apply the blood to their doorways, to the left and right and top. In other words, their whole door was surrounded with the blood of the Lamb. And this was a sign, and it would stop the plague, or it would stop the death angel. It's amazing, the blood. And so why did God make this an ongoing festival? Clearly there was a purpose in the slaughtering of the Lamb. The application of the blood was to save them from their present crisis, right? From Egypt and from the plague. Why make it an ongoing festival? Because God wanted them to remember. Tell me if this sounds familiar to you. Do this in remembrance of me. That's right. So this festival, God had seven of them, but he had this series of three festivals in the spring. He had Pentecost coming shortly afterwards, and then the fall festivals during the harvest time. They were times of remembrance, times of coming together, times of worship. What did God want them to remember when they would take, even to this very day, active and Orthodox Jewish people will still share and celebrate, appropriately so, the Passover. And let me give you four things. If you're taking notes, I'd love for you to jot these down. But he wanted them to remember his protection. Already there had been 10 plagues. I'm sorry, this was plague number 10. There had been 9 plagues. This was 10. He wanted them to remember, hey, when the blood came, when the frogs came, when the gnats came, when the boils came, when all of these plagues came, they didn't touch Israel. And he wanted them to remember that when the death angel came and the firstborn of every household died, there was protection, and not one person in a home that was marked with blood died. Isn't that amazing? God's protection. God's provision. God's provision. It's a remembrance of a meal, of sustenance, of satisfaction. They ate all of the lamb. It was a provision, but then they took bread with them, bread without yeast. And so they had this bread with them, the ongoing provision. And when they got out into the wilderness, what did they have? The manna from heaven, more bread from heaven. There's this ongoing message from God of his faithfulness and provision. And the bread also represents the presence of the Lord, right? The lamb represents Jesus. The bread represents Jesus. And it's this picture that through their struggle, God was with them. God was with them. They consumed them both, really becoming one with the lamb and one with the bread. But then they even took the bread with them, showing God's ongoing presence. And then lastly, God's promises. His protection, his provision, his presence, and his promises. You know, Exodus 23 is pretty amazing list. It follows this listing of laws and rules and regulations, but at the end of that, the last thing they talk about are the seven feasts and festivals. And following that, it goes through this list of blessings. Exodus 23, starting in verse 20, "See, I am sending an angel ahead of you." Now, part of this is in the context of Israel being delivered, but there's this promise of angelic protection and guidance and presence going before you. Verse 22, "Listen carefully, and I will be an enemy to your enemies, and I will oppose those who oppose you." God is going to help us against our enemies. And he even goes so far, again, they're conquering the promised land, but he says, against the Canaanites, Hittites, and Jebusites, I'm going to wipe them out. Pretty amazing. Verse 25, "Worship the Lord your God, and his blessings will be on your food and water." So you have angels, you have help against the enemy, you have blessings on food and water. Now listen, this is where it gets exciting. "I will take away sickness from you. None of you will miscarry or be barren. I will give you a full lifespan." Psalms 105 said he brought Israel forth with silver and gold, and there was not a sick or feeble person among them. So God gave them and blessed them with health. And then he said, "I will send my terror ahead of you and throw into confusion every nation you encounter. I will make your enemies turn and run." And then I love this little verse. I don't know why, but I just happen to like it. "I'll send the hornet ahead of you and drive out the Hivites, Canaanites, and Hittites." God is taking care of our opposition for us. Little by little, I'll drive them out until you have taken possession of the land. I will establish you. He gives the boundaries. I will drive the enemy out before you. All these promises that are attached with the celebration of the festivals and feasts and with the honoring and obedience to God. It's quite amazing. And it's centered on the Lamb. The Lamb. Now, I want to bring this back to Jesus and the Last Supper. So for years and years and years, the Jewish people, the Israelites, had celebrated the Passover, remembering God's provision, God's protection, God's presence, and remembering God's promises and laying claim to them. As they would celebrate the Passover, they would retell the story of deliverance and of the Exodus and of the plagues and of the blood and of the Lamb. And they would pass it on to the next generations. So Jesus, in Luke 22, comes to Jerusalem, and he is with his disciples celebrating, guess what? The Passover meal. Now, the Feast of Unleavened Bread, called the Passover, was approaching. The chief priests and teachers of the law were looking for a way to get rid of Jesus. It talks about Judas. And then verse 7. It came the day of unleavened bread on which the Passover lamb had to be sacrificed. And by the way, Jesus entered Jerusalem on the day the Passover lamb was selected because he was the Lamb of God. And later, right, at the end of the night here is when Jesus goes to the cross. Before that sequence of going to the cross, Jesus sent Peter and John and said, hey, go make provisions for us to eat the Passover. Now listen, they didn't live in Jerusalem. They just showed up in Jerusalem. And so they said, hey, where do you want us to prepare? Now listen, he said, oh, as you enter the city, you're going to see a guy carrying a jar of water. He'll meet you. So just follow him to his house. And when he goes in, you say to the owner of the house, hey, the teacher wants to know where the guest room is that we could eat the Passover together, him and his disciples. And that owner will show you a large upper room, all furnished. Make your preparations there. And so they left and found everything just as Jesus had told them. Isn't that crazy? They're in this huge city, swollen in population. It's the Passover season. And they said, where should we celebrate? Oh, just when you see the guy with the water jar, follow him home. And then when you find the owner of the house, just tell him the teacher's ready to come have dinner. And where should we go? And he'll show you the upper room and you'll be all set. A large room, fully furnished. Isn't that amazing? You know, we tend to worry about everything, don't we? How am I going to pay the bills? What are we going to eat? What happens when I run out of toilet paper? And I know those are legitimate concerns, and I'm kind of making light, but think about it. Look at the detail of God's provision, a messenger, a guide, a house, an upper room, and not just a closet, a large upper room fully furnished. I mean, when God provides, he provides in style. So verse 14, when the hour came, Jesus and his disciples reclined at the table. So he said, I've eagerly desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. For I tell you, I will not eat it again until it finds its fulfillment in the kingdom. And after taking the cup, he gave thanks. And he said, take this, divide it amongst you, for I will not drink of the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God comes. And he took bread, and he gave thanks, and he broke it, and he gave it to them. And he said, this is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, he took the cup after supper, and he said, this cup is a new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for you. Now, Jesus was fulfilling the law of the Old Testament. He was becoming, literally, the sacrificial lamb. He was ushering in a new covenant in his blood. And as he was sharing of the traditional Passover meal, the lamb and the bitter herbs and the bread without leaven, he was ushering in really a new season. There's nothing wrong with continuing to celebrate the traditional Passover meal, but Jesus entering into a new covenant I call this sermon Passover 2.0. He took what was traditionally the Passover meal, which was for what purpose? Remembrance. And he ushered us into a new covenant version of a meal of remembrance. What was at the core of the original Passover? The lamb, or we could say the body, and the blood. Guess what's at the core of our new covenant meal we call communion, we call the Lord's Supper, we call the Eucharist. At the core is the bread representing the lamb or the body, and the cup representing the blood. Isn't that amazing? The body and the blood. Jesus was the sacrificial lamb. And because Jesus was the final sacrifice, the symbol of the lamb is no longer necessary. We moved to the bread. He is the bread of life because he was the final sacrifice. And he said, "This cup is a new covenant in my blood." So what are we supposed to remember as we come to the communion table? Guess what? We're supposed to remember his protection. Right? He is an ever-present help in our times of trouble. He is a friend that sticks closer than a brother. He is as close as the mention of his name. He is our protector. He is our healer. By his stripes we are healed. His protection, number two, is provision. Right? I have come that you might have life and have it abundantly. My God shall supply all of your needs according to his glorious riches in Christ Jesus. As we take the communion elements, we remember his protection, his healing grace. We remember his provision, his abundance. We remember his presence. Jesus said, "I am the bread of life." As we take of communion, we remember that God is with us. He never fails. He never forgets. He is never absent. He is ever present. And we remember his promises. All his promises are yes and amen. Now, here's an interesting part of the original Passover. They took the lamb, they slaughtered it, they roasted it, they consumed it. But with the blood, they had to apply it to their door. Now listen, if they took a lamb, if they slaughtered a lamb, if they roasted the lamb, if they consumed the lamb, and if they did not apply the blood, you know what? No protection. It seems crazy, but that's exactly how God explained it. You had to not only make the sacrifice, but you had to apply the blood. Fast forward to Jesus. He's in the upper room. He's giving the new covenant. "This is a new covenant in my blood." Jesus was and is our Lamb of God, our sacrifice. And guess what? Just like Israel, the sacrifice has been made, but if we don't apply the blood in our lives, we're missing out on the protection, the provision, the presence, and the promises. We're missing it. Apply the blood. You say, "Pastor, that sounds a little weird. Now you've just gone off the deep end. Everything was good, and now you're getting off there." Now listen, I'm going to give you a couple of quick examples. We're going to move into our communion time, and maybe 10 minutes from right now, I just want to give you a couple examples and bring us into communion. There's a tremendous story, and I'm going to give you the short form, of a guy named Job, J-O-B. It's not Job, it's Job, and it's in the book of Job, and it's a strange, odd, and wonderful story of this guy named Job and how the enemy comes to attack him, and he loses much, but ultimately is restored. But here is the part of Job that I love the best. Job chapter 1, he had children. And it said, "When a period of feasting had run its course, Job would send and have them purified, his children, his family." And this is what he would do. Job, "Early in the morning, he would sacrifice a burnt offering for each of them, thinking, 'Perhaps my children have sinned and cursed God.'" And this was Job's regular custom. What would he do? he if he had any concerns about the protection or the godliness or the spiritual well-being of his children, he would offer for every one of them, every time he had concern, a blood sacrifice. And guess what that produced down in verse 10? It's that strange part where the enemy comes to God and God says, hey, I think you've been eyeing my man Job. And listen to what Satan said. He said, does Job fear God for nothing? He said, you have put a hedge around him and his household and everything he has. You have blessed the work of his hands so that his flocks and herds are spread throughout the land. How did Job get a hedge about him that the enemy couldn't penetrate? I believe it was because he applied the blood sacrifice over his family regularly. Let's look at the armor of God, Ephesians chapter 6. Very familiar if you're a Christian. If you've read your Bible, you've probably heard of the armor of God. Ephesians 6:10 says, be strong in the Lord and the power of his might. And then it says this, put on the full armor of God. And it goes into all the pieces. But I want you to get this. It doesn't say, hey, Christian, you live in the armor. No, it says, hey, Christian, you have available to you protection, armor. You've got to put it on. You've got to put it on. You've got to apply the blood. You've got to be a participant. Psalms 91 is a verse many are holding on to these days. I think there's no better. The Psalm of Protection in Psalm 91. And it's a promise of God. It paints a picture of God's favor. Under his wings I take refuge. But listen to the beginning part of it. He who dwells in the shelter of the Most High will rest in the shadow of the Almighty. And then it goes this. I will say of the Lord, he is my refuge, my fortress, my God, in whom I trust. Surely he will save you from the fowler's snare, deadly pestilence. He will cover you with his feathers. Under his wings you take refuge. His faithfulness will be your shield and rampart. You will not fear the terror of night or the arrow by day, nor the pestilence that stalks in the darkness. Here it is. Nor the plague. You shall not fear the plague that destroys at midday. 1,000 may fall at your side, 10,000 at your right hand, but it will not come near you. And it goes on. But who gets to claim that blessing? What activates the blessing of Psalm 91? It started right here with verse 2, I will say of the Lord. I will say of the Lord. Who is under his wings? Who is protected? The one who says of the Lord that he is my refuge, my fortress, my God, in whom I trust. How do we apply the promise of Psalm 91 with our words? How do we apply the armor of God with our words? How did Job apply the hedge of protection? For him, he was Old Covenant, Old Testament. With a blood sacrifice, he applied the blood. In the New Testament, the Bible says our sacrifice of praise is a fruit of our lips. We use our words. You know, there's an old school thing that some of the old Christians say. I guess I'm an old Christian because I like to say it. And they say, I plead the blood. Now, I got to be honest. I had to do a little study on this because I heard these things. I would say these things. And then I figured out one day, I don't even know what that means. I don't even know what that means. It just sounds good. It sounds churchy. It sounds tough. It sounds like it's like a good prayer. But this is what it means. It means that the blood of Jesus, just like it was for Job, provides a hedge of protection. But we have to, just like in the Passover, we have to apply the blood. And that's what plead the blood is. It's applying the blood. It's, you don't have to say those exact words, I plead the blood. But you do have to use words to apply the blood. I declare the blood covering over my family. I plead the blood of Jesus over my family. I'm announcing that we are protected by the blood of Jesus. I'm declaring that the blood of the Lamb, Jesus Christ, covers me. However you want to say it. But we use our words to literally declare, I am covered. I am protected. I am shielded by the blood of the Lamb. I apply the benefits of the blood to my life. So we do that with our words, and I want to bring this to a conclusion today, that communion is it a remembrance, of course, of God's provision, God's protection, God's promises, God's presence. But you know what communion also is? It's an application. It's a remembrance of the blood. And in our prayers, we are applying the blood. Communion is a remembrance and an application of the blood. I want to encourage you right now, just if you get your elements handy, and in just a couple minutes, we are going to actually partake of our communion elements and share together in Holy Communion. And you know what's amazing? 2,000 years ago when Jesus died, in that blood was protection, right? In His broken body was healing and deliverance and peace. His presence is promised to be with us forever, and His promises are yes and amen. And what's amazing is when we come to the communion table, those promises are still available to us. That protection is still available to us. That healing grace is still available to us. So I want to ask real quick before we move to our communion time. Really the only guideline for communion is it's really a celebration of a follower of Jesus, of a believer, because we are remembering and proclaiming the goodness of God. And so if you are watching today and you're interested in the Christian faith, you're interested in Jesus, but you've not made a decision to follow Jesus, I want to encourage you today. That would be the best decision you could possibly make. Jesus led us into, through His blood, what we call a new covenant in His blood. And with that comes the forgiveness of our sins and the adoption into God's family and the promise of eternal life. But it requires of us to accept the sacrifice and accept the offer. And a covenant is mutually agreed upon and willfully entered into. And can I encourage you today to enter into that relationship? I just want to lead you in a prayer. I encourage you, if you are a Christian, pray with me as an affirmation. And if you're not a follower of Jesus, start today with this declaration of faith in Jesus. Pray with me. Thank you, Jesus, for giving your life as a sacrifice for my sins. I repent for the sin that's in my life. And I thank you for forgiveness. And today I declare that Jesus is Lord and Savior and King of my life. I choose to follow Jesus from this day forward. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen. Well, this time we're going to share in communion. It's so exciting. And listen, I am expecting that not, there's no magic, whether you have grape juice or whether you had to use water or some kind of other juice, or who knows what's in your cup, and who knows exactly what kind of bread. It's not about what specifically you're taking. It's that these symbols point to Jesus. These symbols point to Jesus. And I want to read this for you from Isaiah chapter 53. It says, "Surely He took up our infirmities, carried our sorrows, yet we considered Him stricken by God, smitten by Him and afflicted. But He was pierced for our transgressions, He was crushed for our iniquities, and the punishment that brought us peace was laid upon Him, and by His wounds we are healed." I want to encourage you to take your bread at this time. Jesus broke the bread that He had, an unleavened bread, a pure, spotless lamb. And I'm going to lead us in a prayer as we take the bread together. 1 Corinthians teaches us about communion, and it talks about rightly discerning the body of Christ, and it's a key to physical health. And it just means this, that the broken body of Jesus, as I read in Isaiah, by His wounds we are healed. The punishment that brought us peace was laid upon Him. And so I want you to hold that piece of bread with me, and I want you to pray out loud with me. Thank you, Jesus, for your body broken for me. Thank you, Jesus, for paying the price for my health, for my wholeness, for my deliverance, for my joy, for my peace, for my strength, and for my physical health. As I take this bread, I'm laying claim to the promises of God for my life. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's take together. And Jesus took the cup and he said, "This is a new covenant in my blood." I want you to hold your cup with me and I want you to pray. Pray out loud with me. I just think it's powerful when we can verbalize our words of faith and our claim of God's goodness and his promises. Pray with me. Thank you, Jesus, for your blood. You are and you were the perfect, spotless lamb. You were the sacrifice. And your blood was shed for me. Today, I take this cup in remembrance of your blood. And as I receive this cup, I receive your grace. I receive your power. I receive your anointing. I receive your forgiveness. And I apply or plead the blood of Jesus over my life, over my family, over our physical bodies, over our minds, over our thoughts, over our home. And we declare a blood covering over our home, our household, our family. We thank you for health. We thank you for victory. We thank you this moment that sick bodies are made well. We thank you that immunities are lifted and made strong. We thank you that you strengthen us in our time of weakness. We thank you for peace that passes understanding. In Jesus' name, amen. Let's take the cup together. Amen. I just want to bless you as we come to conclusion. And I want to give you one more encouragement, if I may. Communion was never designed by God to be only celebrated in the church. Remember, this is Passover 2.0. Passover was a huge festival, but it was celebrated ultimately in homes once a year. Jesus brings the new covenant, and he says, "Do this in remembrance of me as often as you eat or drink." Now, that's not always practical in modern life, but it wasn't really supposed to be limited to once a month in the church. And I want to encourage you, take communion in your homes. Why? Because it's an application of the blood of Jesus. It's a remembrance of his goodness, his faithfulness, his promises, his protection, his provision. And I tell you, Melissa and I have been taking communion every day for about the last week, just because we want to apply the blood of Jesus. We've twice in the last week, we've done that with all the kids. I can't tell you what to do specifically, but all I can tell you is you can't go wrong with taking communion and declaring the lordship of Jesus over your home and your household and pleading the blood of Jesus over your lives of you and your family members. And so I encourage you in your homes, take communion regularly, often, and celebrate God's goodness. With that, I want to just speak a blessing over you, and we're going to bring this to a conclusion today. Thanks again, and we'll see you back next Sunday. Lord, I bless each one in Jesus' name. May they be in health and prosper as their souls prosper. May your grace and peace rest upon them. May you strengthen parents who have kids at home, and may you bless kids and families. We pray for those who are maybe at risk, elderly, or those with compromised immune systems. We declare health and favor over every single body and every single mind, and we declare the joy of the Lord is our strength. And we declare to this coronavirus that you are defeated by the blood of Jesus, and you've got to pass over our homes. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. God bless you. We'll see you back next Sunday, 10:45.